To give you the background on a dweller on two planets, it was dictated by Philos the Tibetan to his amanuensis, Frederick S. Oliver. The word amanuensis means secretary. The book was begun in 1883 or 4 when Frederick Oliver was 17 or 18 years old. It was completed in 1886 and published in 1899. The subject is the story of Philos' life in his embodiment as Zalem Numinus on the ancient continent of Atlantis, the greatest nation on earth at that time. The book also covers Philos' embodiment in the 19th century as an American by the name of Walter Pearson. It shows how he reaped the karma he had made 12,000 years before on Atlantis. I am specifically teaching the book, A Dweller on Two Planets by Philos, because it gives to us an understanding of karma as well as grace. The grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which gives us the opportunity to live and serve again to balance karma. In the Old Testament, we had a dispensation of the law, and very few individuals in that period of history retained the fusion to the Holy Christ self. Therefore, they did not have the mediator, and Jesus Christ had not come as the Son of God to fulfill the promise of God to draw all men back to him through that Son. So the Old Testament under the law of Moses gives us the example of the harshness of the law descending. Moses himself would act as mediator before the people. And when God said he would punish them and he would bring great calamities to come upon them, Moses would reason with him and urge him to mitigate his wrath against his people. So sometimes Moses was successful and sometimes he was not. With the coming of Jesus Christ, the mediator is in embodiment through Jesus. He came for the specific purpose to reignite the threefold flame and to make of us sons of God to whoever would believe on his name and receive him. We have that same opportunity today. In the last 2,000 years, because of the dispensation of Jesus Christ, there has been a tremendous opportunity for souls to reestablish their fusion with the Holy Christ self through Jesus, and ultimately with Jesus. The reigniting of the threefold flame is a part of that process for those who have lost that flame. The pendulum of Orthodox Christianity has swung to a far position of saying that only grace is necessary. And the Lutheran position is that Jesus did it all on the cross. In the few hours he was on that cross, he atoned for all the sins of the world, past, present, and future. Therefore, all that anyone has to do is to call upon the name of Jesus Christ, accept him as Savior, and they will go to heaven. Now, there is no conditioning in the mind of Martin Luther or Lutherans today. So sins that are done thereafter may be forgiven and are not consequential in this salvation exclusively by grace. Other Christians believe that grace is a part of it, that faith is necessary, of course, as Lutherans do, but they also say that faith without works is dead. And that statement by the Apostle James was rejected by Martin Luther. So what we find is that no matter what the gradations of belief, the basic Orthodox Christian tenet today is that you do not have to balance your karma because Jesus paid the price. My feeling about the book of Philos is that it makes quite clear that that grace is present and that we are bound to follow the teachings of the Old and New Testament and to know that grace and to know that union with God through the heart of Jesus Christ, but that does not exempt us from our karma. Our karma must be paid. And what this book shows is that Most often, as we find also in Hindu teachings, the cycles of returning karma do not return in the same life as that karma is made. This often explains to us why so much injustice goes uncorrected and the evildoer may continue in his evil ways for a lifetime and to all appearances will not be stopped in any measure. This is a puzzlement to us, except when we understand the law of reincarnation along with karma. Reincarnation says that these cycles come full circle in their time as the fruit that ripens on the tree. And when that karma is ripe, then we are there to reap it. And therefore, we never know from day to day why we are reaping calamities or situations. We don't seem to necessarily connect them with any recent right or wrong that we may have done. This is because of the wide orb of the cycles returning. This text then gives us an eye view of ancient Atlantis, where all of us were embodied. We were there. Many of you were there in the Golden Ages. Many of you were there in the decline. Many of you were there in the hour of the cataclysm of the sinking of Atlantis, which, as you know, happened in stages, beginning about 12,000 years ago to 11,500. So we are all dealing with those records today, and we are dealing with now a final embodiment such as that which was had by Walter Pearson. And we can understand in the light of what we must fulfill in this final embodiment, what kind of karma we may have had not only on Atlantis, but in the interim. This book becomes a fundamental text for every chela on the path, but it is heightened in its meaning by the teachings of the Ascended Masters, which are added to it, almost as an update. In a decade, it will be 100 years since this book was written. Many new teachings have come to light, many new dispensations. What I would like to tell you about our belief in karma is that we do not believe that every last jot and tittle of every act and deed that we have ever committed against life must necessarily be balanced before we experience the resurrection and the ascension. First of all, we have the more recent dispensation, which has come since this book was written, regarding the fact that the Lords of Karma and the 24 Elders have stated that we may make our ascension having balanced 51% of our karma. Now, in addition to that, we should understand that God does not deal our karma to us as punishment. Karma is a manifestation of an impersonal law as well as a personal law. There is the law of justice and there is the law of mercy. There is the law of divine intercession and also the guru-chela relationship where the guru may take on for a time a certain portion of a chela's karma or for extraordinary and exemplary service may balance it entirely. The purpose for us to bear our karma is because karma is our teacher. We must learn the lessons of how and why we misused the energy of life. Next, we receive our karma because we are, in the final analysis, responsible for all of our actions, our words, and our deeds, for the causes we have set in motion. If, therefore, we have a certain karma that is grievous to be borne, that may require several lifetimes to balance, and if we embody and live a life of service combined with a violet flame, giving much mantras and decrees, and totally committing ourselves to the service of life and giving all that we are, God may take this exemplary sign of our daily deeds and shorten the days of our travail. And God has said he would do this for the sake of the elect, to shorten our days, so that he will receive a certain set of deeds, a certain series of long suffering under a certain burden with virtue and great holiness accompanying it, and say, you have borne enough, you have satisfied the law, and by the grace of Jesus Christ, you may come up higher because you have proven that you will not make this mistake again. So in that sense of the word, the 100% of karma may not be the full 100% of every last situation that we have ever been under. So that is a Hindu concept, and it is largely true, but there is grace, and there is intercession, there is mercy, as well as justice.